CN Channel 8 Sports presents Princeton Tigers football. This afternoon, the Princeton Tigers take on the Columbia Lions. And welcome to Baker Field in New York City, site of today's Ivy League clash between the Princeton Tigers and the Columbia Lions. It's a rainy, miserable day in Manhattan, and certainly the weather will be a factor this afternoon. Hello again, everyone. I'm Lou Brogno. Glad you could join us for what is a very important game for the Princeton Tigers. Princeton last week losing to Harvard and Columbia coming off a win, and therefore this game becomes an important clash as we head into the last part of the Ivy League season. Alongside is former Princeton linebacker Pete Milano. And Pete, Princeton last week coming off a very difficult loss in Cambridge against the Harvard Crimson. 2 points. Question is, can Princeton bounce back today against this Columbia team?
Well, Lou, I think they can. And in my opinion, almost as important as Coach Steve Tosh's ability to game plan is going to be his ability to motivate. It was a disheartening loss. And with two losses in the Ivy League, their chances at an Ivy League title seem remote. There's nobody in the stadium that needs to bounce back more than their senior quarterback, number 13, Harry McKelney. Harry had, without question, his worst game as a Princeton Tiger. He was 6 of 36 for 65 yards. As goes Harry McKelney, so goes the Princeton offense. So it's going to be important to see how he reacts today.
It's been a disappointing campaign so far for Columbia. They're 2-4, following a stellar 8-2 campaign a year ago. But the Lions feel they may be turning the corner after last week's victory against Yale.
Well, Lou, they got some momentum. I mean, they snapped a 3-game losing streak, and they got their first Ivy League win. But this is a rebuilding year for Coach Ray Tellier. They don't have the horses. They lost some critical seniors. And at this point, they ran close to last in most categories, offensively and defensively, in the Ivy League. The real challenge today is going to be to deal with the stifling Princeton defense that ranks number one in the Ivy League in scoring defense and number 6 in the country. If they do that, they have to have a big game from their senior quarterback, Bobby Thomason, and number 24, their very, very talented tight end, Bert Bondi.
All right, we're just moments away from kickoff. It's Princeton versus Columbia. You're watching Princeton Tigers football on RCN.
You ever get the feeling other shows are filming the same scenes we are?
No. Why do you say that?
Hang on, Freddy!
Hang on! Tommy, hang on!
Ready for something different? USA Network, the duel for the common show.
The best cable channels can only be found in RCN's Family Value Package. Our value package is the complete cable package. Call 1-800-321-0544.
Strong safety number 31, Tom Rudwick. At quarterback, number 9, Jamani Lee.
And welcome back to Baker Field, where the rain continues to fall. Lawrence A. Ween Stadium is the name of the stadium here on the campus of Columbia University. The Lions in their, we'll call them, powder blue uniforms, and the Tigers in their road whites. And boy, they've gotten a lot of use out of those uniforms this year, dubbed the Road Warriors. The orange helmets and orange numerals. Princeton will kick right to left on your screen. And the Tigers, of course, will defend the goal to the right. Pete, what does Princeton have to do to win this football game today, and also Columbia as well?
Hello.
There he is.
Well, why don't you repeat that question?
Okay, well, here's the kickoff first, and then we'll go to this. The ball bounces into the end zone. It'll be first down and 10 at the 20-yard line for Columbia. The Lions up front to their center, Brian Gordon, 6'2", 265. Marcel Deans and Ray Jarena are the guards. Jay DuPurchase and Matt Radley are the tackles, and Burt Bondi starts at tight end, junior, 6'1", 245. Armand Dawkins is the wide receiver, 6'2", sophomore, 180. Salu Ba, the flanker, a sophomore, 6'1", 230. Lendell Thompson is a sophomore fullback. And getting the start, Norman Hayes, sophomore, 5'8", 190, behind quarterback Bobby Thomason. And the handoff goes up the middle, across the 20 to the 22-yard line. A short pickup, it'll be second down and eight. The Princeton defense, which has been stellar all season long, across the front, Griff King and Dan Swingos, the defensive ends, Mark Whaling and David Ferrara, the tackles. The linebackers, Jamie Toddings, Mike Veronese, although Jim Salters probably gets the start in the middle, and Tim Green. We'll give you the secondary after this play. It's a second down and eight for the Lions at the 22-yard line. I formation for Columbia. Receiver split left and right. Norman Hayes carries the football up the middle and scoots across the 25 up near the 28-yard line. The secondary for the Lions, for the Tigers, excuse me, Damani Leach and Jerry Wilson at the corners, and Ryan Demler and Tom Ludwig at the safeties. Ludwig, an interesting story. This is his 30th start, and that ties him with a number of players in Princeton history for the most starts in a career.
That's quite a feat. He ties a record of Dave Patterson, Bushnell Award winner, and Carter Westfall, great offensive lineman for Princeton back in the early 90s.
Norman Hayes up over the top on a third down and one. He had to get just across the 30. And it depends on where the officials mark it. Looks like a first down. Columbia gets the first down at the 30-yard line. All right, Pete, we'll try this again. What does Princeton have to do to win this football game, and likewise Columbia?
Well, Lou, their defense has been the stalwart part of this team all year long. As we watch Norman Hayes go up the middle for the first down, the defense currently ranks number 6 in the country in scoring defense and number 1 in the Ivy Leagues. They need to have a consistent ball game, just like they have in the previous 6 games.
First and 10, Columbia at the 30-yard line, and it's play action. Thomason rolls out, right side, throws, has a receiver. That's Bondi, the tight end, across the 45, up to the 47, a very good-looking play. Burt Bondi started at fullback last year, has moved to tight end, comes into the game with 26 receptions.
Well, as we watch the replay here, Bobby Thomason displaying his great mobility. He rolls out on a bootleg, and it's Bondi on a cross pattern. The Print defense were more worried about Burt Bondi than any one single player on the Columbia offense. He's fourth in the league in receptions right now, Lou.
And Columbia has a first down at their own 47-yard line. One set back behind Thomason, and twin receivers go to the left side. Princeton shows a little blitz, and the flip goes to Hayes, who fumbles the football and then falls on top of it at the 42. Norman Hayes, tough getting the handle on that one, and you're going to see probably quite a bit of that day on a very nasty day for college football. Well, listen, it's been that way the last 2 weeks. Certainly it was that way in Cambridge a week ago as well.
Lou and I almost blew away down on the field. Monsoon-like conditions. The weather report calls for perhaps 40-degree gusts, 40-mile-an-hour gusts, and rain throughout the afternoon, Lou. We're going to see a lot of turnovers.
Split backs behind Thomason. Give it to Hayes. Breaks a tackle, but then is pummeled behind the line of scrimmage. Might have picked up a yard or so, but not much more than that. Ross on the tackle. Big Ross Tucker, a freshman, 6'5", 245.
Ross Tucker's contributed throughout the year. We should expect to see a bit of him today. But the Princeton coaches lauded the entire defense, both defensive line, linebackers, and defensive backs. They've been incredibly consistent all year long.
Third down and about 14 for the Lions at the 42-yard line. One set back, Thomason straight back to throw. Has protection, fires over the middle, incomplete. Intended for the tight end, Bondi. Tim Green came up to make the hit, and the Tiger defense holds. Columbia will have to punt.
Ooh, that was a good job on the part of Princeton's secondary. They had very good coverage. As we see, the Columbia offensive line gives Thomason some time. He's forced to go to his underneath receiver. Timmy Green's right there. If Bondi catches it, he would have been short of the first down in any event.
Ryan Kiernan is in to punt for the Lions, averaging 42 yards per kick, and Damani Leach stands back at the 25-yard line. It's a line drive kick that bounces at the 25 and then takes a good Princeton bounce out of bounds at the 26-yard line. So the Tigers will put it in play at that point. Their center is Bernard Marsick, a sophomore, 6'2", 260. Amin Abdullah and Brian Herdman are the guards. Justin Bennett, 6'3", 295, and Steve Lamberton, 6'4", 280, are the tackles. The tight end, Jason Glotzback, he's a junior, 6'3", 245. Ryan Crowley and Philip Wendler start at the wide receiver slots. Mike Clifford is the fullback, Jerry Girado, the tailback, and senior Harry Nakelny out of Sayreville, New Jersey, the quarterback. Hands the ball off to Girado, and he slips down at the 25-yard line. No gain on the play. It'll be second down and 10. The Columbia defense has Rashawn Curry at one defensive end. He's an outstanding player, a junior, 6'2", 260. J.C. Tabio is the other defensive end, a sophomore, 6'2", 210. Matt Kuhn and John Spruill, the defense. Kevin Wright, Jeremy Taylor, and Paul Rowland, the linebackers. We'll give you the secondary after this play on a second down and 11 for the Tigers at the 25-yard line. Split backs, Nakelny hands the ball off. Girado is caught from behind and dragged down at the 27. Pickup of maybe a yard, and it brings up third down and long. The secondary might be the strongest part of the Columbia defense. Roy Hanks is a first-team All-Ivy League selection at the left corner, a senior, 5'8", 165. Michaeli Belanca is at the other corner, a senior, 6'1", 205. Chris Tillotson and Hashim Dalton are the safeties. It is third down, 9 for Princeton. Tigers have the football at their own 26-yard line. Nakelny drops back in the shotgun. 5 minutes gone by, first quarter, no score. Nakelny looks to throw. Hit as he fires, incomplete. He bounced one at the 35-yard line. Intended it looked for Jerry Girado coming out of the backfield, but Princeton will have to punt.
Well, that's not a real impressive start for Princeton's offense, Lou. As we mentioned in the opening, Harry Nakelny probably had his worst game as a Princeton Tiger last week up at Harvard. One interesting note is the coaches seem to indicate that Harry does not like to throw the ball in the foul weather, and that's certainly going to be a problem today if that's the case.
Matt Evans kicked it away. He's had a tremendous year punting for the Tigers. Gets another good kick here. Bounces inside the 20 and drops dead at the 18-yard line. So Columbia will put it in play at that point. The Lions moved the football on their first possession. They were able to run the ball pretty well, but then stalled out near midfield. As you take a look at Bobby Thomason, the 6'2 senior, 205 pounds. Interesting story, Pete. Thomason playing in great pain, has a separated shoulder, which he suffered against Lafayette. It is not his throwing shoulder, but the left shoulder. And that is a problem, obviously, for Thomason. And he's got that linebacker mentality, if you will. You know about that, right, Pete?
Well, I don't know anymore, Lou, but that could be a problem. Princeton is known to come with a big rush, and they've hurt some quarterbacks this year. Thomason's going to have to be awfully careful out there today.
Norman Hayes gets the carry, and he picks up about three on the play. He's a sophomore, 5'8", 190 pounds. Interesting story in the tailback position for Columbia. They've gone through a couple. Jason Bivens was their starting tailback coming in, but he had surgery yesterday for torn ligaments. And then John Toy also was injured. So basically, Hayes, the third-string tailback, but he's playing well. Had 137 yards last week against Yale.
Well, they're fortunate they're so deep at tailback because I watched the game film last week. Jason Bivens is an outstanding runner, and Toy was one of the leading runners in the Ivy League when he got injured.
Thomason running some option, flips it out, but not much there.
That was a great job on the part of Tommy Ludwig, number 31, the strong safety. The entire right side of the Princeton defense did a great job in stringing out that toss play. Ludwig's played like a champion all year long. He was noted among all the coaches as being a real solid performer. Here Columbia runs option, something they haven't shown this year. The Princeton defense swarms inside out, maintaining a good relationship. Good for a very short gain.
Third down, 5. Thomason sets it up. Incomplete. intended in the backfield for Norman Hayes, but that pass just short. Hayes never had a chance, so again the Lions will have to punt the football away. Ryan Kiernan comes in. He was the Ivy League Rookie of the Week for his performance a week ago. 42 yards a punt, and he's booted one 63 yards this season.
When you have a good punter, Lou, similar to the Princeton team, they can almost act as a 12th defender. When you can pin a team back in poor field position, that's absolutely critical to the performance of a defense.
High snap, and it is blocked. Blocked at the line of scrimmage, and the Tigers again with another block. We'll have to see who did it. It looks like it might have been Rocky. If it is, it would be his fourth blocked punt of the year. Not sure, but it looked like number 30 was the man who broke through.
Well, Princeton's currently number 2 in the Ivy League in turnover margin, and turnovers, block punts, interceptions are always huge momentum plays. Let's see, Lou, if we can get an idea who blocked that. It looked like it could have been number 30. In that case, it would have been Rocky Fitizzi, Lou. Again, his fourth block punt of the year. That's unbelievable.
What a season he's having on special teams. Princeton set up here with a first and 10 at the Columbia 27. McKelney flares it out to Girado at the 30. He's hit and spilled right there. Good defensive play for the Lions. Columbia read it well, and coming up was Roy Hanks, the All-Ivy League left corner, to make the tackle.
Well, Lou, Princeton's going to try and get Jerry Girado outside. You know, he's a converted wide receiver. He's only a buck 60. He's not a power runner. He's a great runner in the open field, and Roy Hanks, who is an All-Ivy League cornerback last year, does a great job in tracking him down for a half a yard gain.
Second down and 11. The ball at the 28-yard line. Split backs. McKelney, play action, rolls out left side. Has protection and fires incomplete. Intended for Clifford coming out of the backfield, but that one not close in the general direction of the Princeton fullback.
Well, Princeton ran waggle action there, and apparently, much like last week's game, we had a wide open receiver, and Harry McKelney just overthrew him. Clifford came clean in the flat. Ball was behind him and over his head, Lou.
Meanwhile, a penalty flag on the play, and it is holding, defensive holding against Columbia. Princeton catches a break. It'll be a first down for the Tigers as they march it down inside the 20-yard line at the 18. So a huge break for the Tigers. Princeton 4-2, but most importantly, just 1-2 in the Ivy League after the difficult loss a week ago in Cambridge to Harvard. Here's the pitch. Girado hit and brought down. A good defensive play by the middle linebacker, Jeremy Taylor, who comes into the game with 64 tackles, 38 of them solo on the season.
We saw some great plays on this replay. Hopefully we'll see it, Lou. But we had nice blocking on the part of Princeton's right side of their offensive line. Here we go. We have the fullback, Mike Clifford, making a nice kickout block, but number 31, Taylor, doing a great job of coming inside out and delivering a great blow on the running back for a loss.
Clifford goes in motion. Girado breaks a tackle, spins away, nearly got away at the 17-yard line before he was finally nailed from behind by Paul Rowland, the right outside linebacker. Rowland, a junior, coming in with 62 tackles on the season. Look at Jerry Girado, a sophomore, 453 yards rushing coming in, and he's getting better week after week.
Off of counter action, we see he might have a hole, but again, number 90, defensive tackle for the Columbia Lions, does a tremendous job in fighting off a blocker, and then we see a swarming Columbia defense come and pile on Girado.
Third down, 9. McKelney looks to throw out of the shotgun. He fires. It is nearly intercepted. Let's see. It might have been picked. It is intercepted. Picked off by Hasheem Dalton, the strong safety, plated well, and McKelney tried to force that one in there, Pete.
Well, he was well covered. Hasheem did a tremendous job in coverage. We saw an out pattern. Watch it on the replay. McKelney receives good outside protection. He rolls behind the tackle box and delivers a decently thrown ball, but it is into coverage. Number 12 makes a great jump on the ball. comes up with a big interception to negate the Princeton turnover.
That's a key interception because that destroys a Princeton scoring opportunity. The Tigers certainly in field goal range for kicker Alex Sirk. Ball is fumbled on the snap. Penalty flies, so just a mess there for Columbia at the four-yard line. 5:51 remaining, first quarter, no score from Baker Field in New York, where Columbia and Princeton are battling. And the rain coming down very hard right now. This is probably the strongest and hardest that it has rained all afternoon.
Reminiscent of the 1950 hurricane game, Lou, between Dartmouth and Princeton. You were a youngster at the time. Do you remember the game?
Now, wait a minute now.
Hold on now.
Hold on. High formation for the Lions at the two-yard line. It's a first down and about 12. The handoff up the middle, nothing there. Princeton stifling at the line of scrimmage against the run.
Well, Princeton stacked the line of scrimmage with eight defenders, daring Columbia to run. Number 54, big surprise for the year. Jim Salters made a nice tackle on that play, knifing through the Columbia offensive line.
It's second down and call it 13. Officials call time momentarily. And looks like David Ferrara, the defensive tackle, the sophomore out of Ramsey, New Jersey, might be shaken up a little bit. He heads to the sidelines.
Ferrara's been Princeton's most consistent rusher all year. In talking to defensive coordinator Steve Verbit, he said that he's the player that can consistently give them a rush when they're only in a four-man front.
Princeton has really been up against it, the defense, the last few weeks. The last three opponents were in the top 12 in offense in Division I AA, so they have responded well. Handoff up the middle. Hit and dropped is Norman Hayes. He might have picked up a yard or so, not much more. Tim Green in on the tackle for the Tigers.
A host of Princeton defenders all over Hayes on that play. This Princeton defense has been stifling, Lou. And Timmy Green has been probably its best performer all year. His performance last week against Harvard was nothing short of miraculous. He didn't practice a down all week, Lou. He was hobbled with a hamstring injury, and he came up with a Ivy League Player of the Week game.
Out of the eye, Columbia runs the football, but there's nothing there. Hayes carried the ball, was knocked down after a one-yard gain, and Princeton again has forced Columbia to punt the football away.
Very conservative play calling on the part of Ray Tellier. With the sloppy conditions, we've already seen the ball mishandled. It's probably a wise decision. You'd hate to get down early to this Princeton team.
Kiernan is in punt formation. He stands in the end zone. Princeton figures to get excellent field position out of this exchange. Tigers have 10 men on the line of scrimmage. And the kick is a high end-over-end kick that Leach Fields fumbles. Ball is loose at the 32. And a mad scramble at the 32-yard line. Looks like Princeton can with the ball. It will be Princeton's ball at the 33-yard line. Almost a very dangerous play for the Tigers.
Well, Damani Leach, a normally sure-handed punt returner, mishandled that ball. Princeton again was, this may be the a consistent theme throughout the entire day, Lou, but Princeton fortunate to recover the loose ball on that play.
McKelney in at quarterback, hands the ball up the middle, crashing across the 30, down near the 27-yard line. Damian Taylor on the carry. Taylor, the sophomore out of Norfolk, Nebraska, with 213 yards rushing coming into the game.
When talking to offensive coordinator Joe Susan Liu, he thought that Princeton could definitely run the ball and put the hammer to this Columbia defensive line. He thought that it was one of the poorer or more average, to put it more in a better light, defensive lines you'll see all year. So we're going to see Princeton run the ball a lot today.
And especially on a day like today, that running game, a very important factor for the Tigers. Damian Taylor carries the football once again.
Taylor's a good size back. He's a very more of a bruising runner, similar to Mark Washington, their outstanding senior that graduated last year.
Third down and one for the Tigers. Princeton comes up to the 24-yard line with 2:40 remaining first quarter, no score. And the handoff out of the eye goes up the middle to Taylor. He's hit and he is dropped. Doesn't look like he got to where he needed to go to pick up the first down. He was hit and driven back at the 24-yard line. On the bottom of the pile is Jim Armstrong, backup defensive tackle, a junior, 6'2", 275.
Well, they ran straight ISO on that play. They only needed about a yard, but I think they were turned back. Great job on the part of the interior. The Columbia defensive line led by Jim Armstrong to stack that play up.
Now Princeton will go on a fourth down and one at the 23-yard line. Tigers come up in the eye. Damian Taylor, the deep back. Bruce Erb, the fullback, goes in motion. And McKelney goes on a quarterback sneak. And I think he got it, Pete. He needed to get to the 23. And unless they get a very generous spot, I'm not sure that he got there.
Well, Lou, Princeton's only converted on 11%, one of 11 of their fourth down tries this year. Again, we'll see if the officials are smiling on the Princeton offense today. It's going to be very close. Looked like they got a decent surge, but at the last minute, some Columbia defenders got a nice helmet on to Kelney.
And Columbia indeed holds. Princeton did not get the first down. A good job by the Columbia defense.
Well, that's an outstanding job by Columbia. They rank close to the bottom in most defensive categories. As a matter of fact, they're tied for last in scoring defense, giving up 26.8 points a game. Last in total defense, giving up 383 yards a game. And last in rushing defense. They put in a very credible performance early on in this game, Lou.
So Columbia takes over the Lions with the football at the 23-yard line. 2 minutes, 2 seconds left in a scoreless first quarter. Man goes in motion and twin receivers go to the right. Thomason throws out there, incomplete. He had sent a man in motion. That was
number 25, Chris Tillotson, I believe, on that play.
He plays defense as well.
Watch Tillotson in motion here. This is an interesting play. They try and hit him actually back in the backfield, give him an opportunity to use his speed. As you know, Lou, Tillotson has 6 interceptions on defense. He's one of the leaders in 1AA.
Split backs now behind Thomason. 9 of 14 offensive plays have been handoffs to Norman Hayes. And he gets the ball this time. He breaks a tackle, scoots ahead, and is upended at the 30-yard line. Finally brought down to 31. Hayes did a great job. He broke a tackle in the backfield after Princeton had the play diagnosed.
His size and agility reminds me a bit of Oakland Raider running back Napoleon Kaufman. Columbia loves to run the draw, and they run it well here. We see zone blocking on the part of the offensive lineman, and then a great individual effort on the part of Norman Hayes, number 34. He runs ahead for a first down. He gets walloped at the end by a host of Princeton defensive backs, but that was an outstanding run. Looks like he's short of the first down. Great effort on his part.
Third and two, Hayes carries. He didn't get there. He was hit and then dropped. He'll be about a yard shy. It is fourth down and a good play by David Ferrara, also Ross Tucker, in on the tackle for the Tigers.
Ferrara obviously not slowed by that ankle injury that he seemed to suffer before. It'll be real important for Princeton to have him in the game. He's a great run defender as well as a great pass rusher.
And Columbia will punt again. Damani Leach drops back to the 35-yard line. And Ryan Kiernan is in punt formation. Good snap. Princeton rushes hard. It's a line drive kick that bounces at the 37 and then rolls to about the 34-yard line. So Princeton will put it in play at that point.
It's a nice kick into the wind, very low, kept it low. Fortunately, went over Damani Leach's head.
Well, Princeton has not gotten the job done here in the first quarter offensively, Pete. 3 possessions, a punt, an interception, and they gave it over on downs.
This is not the way that the Princeton coaches wanted to start this game off. They were hoping again that Harry McKelney would snap back sharply from his performance last week. It hasn't happened yet.
split backs behind McKelney, who has taken every snap this season at quarterback for the Tigers. And he goes down. Looks like he tripped over his own man as he was going back at the 26-yard line.
Well, he looked like he got tangled up with Damian Taylor as he went out of the pocket and looked like a...
And that's the end of the first quarter. So the first period of football is in the books. The score, Princeton nothing, Columbia nothing.
You ever get the feeling other shows are filming the same scenes we are?
No. Why do you say that?
Hang on!
Ready for something different? USA Network, the cure for the common shell.
Just about ready to get underway. Princeton moving left to right on your screen. McKelney on a second down. Fires. It is incomplete. He was going down as he delivered the football. And it looked like it was intended for Ray Cole at about the 45. So it'll bring up a third down for the Tigers. Lou Brogno, Pete Milano, glad you could join us here on RCN's continuing coverage of Princeton Tiger football. The Tigers coming in at 4-2, 1-2 in the Ivy League, in a critical game here for them against Columbia, trying to bounce back after a difficult loss at Harvard a week ago.
A little disconcerting for the Princeton coaches. They have not started off well offensively, Lou. You probably have the statistics, but if they have more than 20 yards of total offense, I'd be surprised.
Well, there's a flag on the play and gives us an opportunity to tell you that the first quarter, offensively, a good word would be, I think, anemic for both teams. Columbia, 40 yards. Princeton had 6 yards of total offense
My
in the first
goodness.
Quarter.
Well, they only had 159 total yards up at Harvard. And I know that if you ask the Princeton offensive coaches whether or not they thought they'd outproduce their previous game, I'm sure they'd tell you they would. Against a Columbia defense that's ranked last in the league in scoring and total defense.
Well, sheets of rain now coming down. The rain is falling hard here in the second quarter. McKelney in the shotgun rolls out. Now he pitches ahead, a disastrous play. Gerardo lucky to hang on to the football as he was sandwiched just as the ball reached him. So Princeton will have to punt. Matt Evans drops back into punt formation, the junior out of Bel Air, Texas.
You watch this play out of the shotgun. Princeton runs a little shuttle pass, normally meant to deceive the defense, but no one's fooled on this play. Columbia stopped that for a 4-yard loss.
Evans gets it away. Line drive kick that bounces across the 50. And we'll roll to about the 48, and Columbia will put it in play at that point.
Princeton again relying on the strength of their defense here, Lou. Both teams, for that matter, putting in a nice effort defensively. I'm not sure if it's the defense or if it's just the conditions making it difficult for the offense.
The Lions come up to the line of scrimmage. Columbia last year went 8-2. That's the most wins for a Columbia team since 1945. Program under head coach Ray Tellier on the upswing. And Thomason hit. He's just scrimmage. Jamie Todd in the blitz made the play. Todding's the senior out of Barnegat, New Jersey. Came in with 42 tackles on the season.
Well, this is a blitzing Princeton team. Last week up at Harvard, they rushed more than 4 players on 43 of 83 defensive plays. Toddings has been their primary agent of destruction. As he comes off the corner, Bobby Thomason doesn't even have a chance. He's got 2 guys in his face. Toddings makes a tremendous play, delivering a crushing blow.
Norman Hayes carries the football, gets up to about the 45, and it will bring up a third down for the Lions. I want to go back to that play momentarily with Thomason. Here's a guy that's playing with a separated shoulder. How many shots like that can he take?
Well, if it's me or you, it's probably one. but he's a tough, hard-nosed kid. Princeton's been able to get to passing quarterbacks all year, and To be honest with you, when I talked to Steve Verbit, they said that if their defense can pin their ears back just on the pass, they can hurt an opposing quarterback. They've got that type of speed and power coming off the corners.
Thomason looks to throw. Now he rolls out of the pocket, still has the football, lets it fly incomplete. Threw it to coverage. Norman Hayes, the intended receiver. Jamie Toddings, who had the sack a couple of plays earlier, that time on coverage, did a good job.
He's very mobile. He bulked up, and so he plays the run a little better. He came in about 225. He's got excellent speed. They use him a lot in the blitz. He's got a number of sacks this year. He's close to the team leader in sacks. He's been a great all-around performer for Princeton this year.
Ryan Kiernan drops back in punt formation. The snap almost over his head. He steps up and gets the punt away. Good job by the Columbia punter. Ball bounces inside the 20, and Princeton will get it at the 18-yard line. Let's see if the Tigers can get it going offensively. By the way, Princeton leads this all-time series with 54 wins. Columbia has won 10 times in this series, but last year, Princeton, of course, defeated Columbia 14-11, and that game really hurt Columbia as far as their chances for the Ivy League title.
Well, Princeton foiled Columbia's bid for an undefeated season as well as an Ivy League title. They played, it was a great game, Lou, a 14-10 game. Unlike today, the conditions were beautiful last year.
First down 10, handoff Gerardo up the middle. He's hit and driven back. And Princeton not really getting a good surge on the offensive line. Gerardo picks up a couple and then knocked down at about the 20-yard line.
Well, they significantly outmanned with regard to both height and weight the Columbia defensive line. Princeton's offensive line averages 6'3", 275. Columbia's defensive line, 6'2", 245. Joe Susan said beforehand, the offensive coordinator, that they should be able to run against them, but they have not been able to do so thus far this game, Lou.
Back blitz, and then receivers out to the right side, throw over the middle to Crowley. Ryan Crowley, the intended receiver, the junior wide receiver, but again an incomplete pass, and another tough week so far for Harry Nikelny. He's struggling.
You know, in all deference to Harry, these are tough conditions for any quarterback. Troy Aikman would have a difficult time throwing the ball with 40-mile-an-hour winds and driving rain, but it's going to be critical that they perhaps change their passing routes to shorter and intermediate routes so they can get this offense in gear.
Nikelny straight back of the shotgun, hit, and it's incomplete. That time, he put the ball in the hands of his receiver, Jerry Gerardo, but he was covered well by left outside linebacker Kevin Wright. It's incomplete, and Princeton will punt.
Well, Columbia came with a blitz on that play. Number 44, Paul Rowland, came hard at Harry Nikelny. It was a good read on the part of Gerardo running a short intermediate route, crossing route, but he was unable to hold on to the ball.
Evans, end-over-end kick that's fielded at the 40-yard line by Roy Hanks, and he steps up inside the 40 to about the 39. Well, the Princeton passing game so far, well, certainly the weather's had an effect on both teams. Princeton 2 of 7, no yards passing. Columbia hasn't done much better, 1 of 5 for 17 yards.
Anemic, to say the least.
Lions, though, have an opportunity. They're in Princeton territory at the 39-yard line with 11 and a half remaining second quarter on a rotten November afternoon for football. Rain falls, not particularly cold, but temperature in the 50s. Hayes hit behind the line of scrimmage, drop. Tim Green with the penetration does the job again. Last week, the Ivy League Defensive Player of the Week with 17 tackles against Harvard. Boy, he's just doing the job. He's been the leading tackler in 13 of 16 Princeton games.
He's just an outstanding player. I mean, he's the horse that drives this cart. He really has got excellent speed. He's very good against the run. He takes on blockers well despite his diminutive size. He's very stocky and real powerful. Just having an all-Ivy type year, Lou.
Second down and 12 at the 42-yard line. Thomason looks to throw. He lofts it up for his receiver. Nearly intercepted on the far sideline. Damani Leach was in position to pick it off, and it actually was a very good play by Armand Dawkins, the sophomore wide receiver, who turned into a defensive player there and knocked it away.
Well, the Princeton coaches were a little bit worried about the size of Columbia's receivers. If we take a look at this play, this is just a quick one-on-one pass. Thomason lofts it up, and he's hoping that number 84, Armand Dawkins, at 6'2", 180, can out-jump 5'11", Damani Leach. Leach makes a good play, and as you said, Dawkins makes a good play in knocking that ball away from what would have been an interception.
Thomason is hit by the Tigers, and again, it is Tim Green who comes in to make the play.
The color of money, Tim Green. He's got excellent quickness, and this, as I said, Lou, this is a blitzing team. The Tigers have 8 zone blitzes and 5 man blitzes. In addition, they have 12 different zone coverages. By any level of football standards, that's a lot of defense. Coach Steven really challenges these guys physically as well as mentally. I'm not so sure that I would be able to memorize all those plays, Lou, if I was still playing.
Outstanding defensive team as Kiernan kicks it high. Leach fumbles again. The ball is loose, still loose inside the 10 at the 8-yard line. Columbia says they've got it. Let's see. The officials have not made the call yet. Still waiting for the official call as they try to get everyone away from the ball. And it is Columbia inside the 10-yard line at the 8. A huge break for the Lions. The second time in the game that Damani Leach has not been able to hang on to the punt.
I mean, this is just inexcusable. I mean, when that ball is on the field, possession is everything in this game. And Damani just, he's been doing this for too long for that to happen on 2 consecutive punts. If I was Coach Tashid, I'd consider making a change. Tommy Ludwig did a great job last year in a very conservative manner in fielding punts. I would consider making a change.
Bobby Thomason brings the Lions up at the 8-yard line. Columbia, golden opportunity. Hand off and breaking tackles. Ball is loose, but they're going to say he's down. Norman Hayes on the carry. He was hit, and then the ball squirted loose, but they say he was down at the 7-yard line.
Well, being a former Princeton Tiger, Lou, I hate to say this, but these are the conditions for an upset. These type of field conditions, tough for either team to get settled in. Here we watch number 34 make a nice run. He follows his blockers. There was a nice iso block on that play, but the Princeton defensive line stacked up the left side of the Columbia offensive line for a short gain.
Columbia second and goal at the 7. Thomason play action, now in trouble, and he's brought down. Big Griff King in to make the play as he knocks him down at the 20. Thomason actually tried to throw the ball at Griff King's leg as he was going down. Watch this play.
We'll see Thomason off of bootleg action try and roll to his right. This is a real seasoned play by Griff King. He stays at home. He's been playing. He started for 2 years. Stays at home, keeps his feet, and is able to bring down a very agile Bobby Thomason.
The Princeton defense just stellar here. They're pushing Columbia back. It's a third down and goal at the 20. Thomason being chased. Chased. The ball is loose, and it is incomplete. Ball is incomplete. Kicked by Norman Hayes. Kind of an odd play, but you can't ask more from your defense than that. First and goal at the 8, and they stop him cold and push him back to the 20.
Like a play out of bloopers or something, Lou. The Princeton defense doing just a yeoman's job here. There was a screen set up, and actually they had blockers out in front, but Princeton did a great job in reading the play, reacting, and again, the pass was errant and sets up a kick.
Kick is up. It is good. Neil Kravitz kicks a 37-yard field goal, and Columbia breaks the ice. The Lions take the lead 3-0 with 8:27 remaining in the second quarter. This telecast of Princeton University football is sponsored in part by McCaffrey Supermarkets. McCaffrey's, there is a difference. McCaffrey Supermarkets are committed to maintaining the highest standards of fresh meats and poultry. McCaffrey's uses only USDA inspected prime and choice meats, as well as certified Angus beef in all their stores. McCaffrey's, the supermarket experience in Princeton, West Windsor, and Yardley, Pennsylvania. Columbia 3 and Princeton nothing. The Lions able to take advantage of the Princeton turnover, and they turn it into points.
Hey, Lou, I mentioned it before, but these are the conditions where an overmatched team can come up with an upset potentially. The weather takes a lot of the skill out of the game, and turnovers become a factor. When that happens, anything can happen. Columbia did a great job in capitalizing on yet another Princeton turnover.
The Lions will kick it off. Neil Kravitz tees it up at the 35-yard line. And the ball, looks like the ball blew off the tee.
Either that or that. I don't know if I've ever seen that before, Lou. The ball was swirling on the tee.
It is windy and rainy. Of course, it's a very blustery wind down there. Almost blew us away in the pregame.
Felt like Mary Poppins, Lou.
I think we didn't need our cars to get back to New Jersey, right? They would have just blown us right across the river. Line drive, Imani Leach at the 5, to the 10, the 15, 20, at the 25. Leach breaks the tackle at the 30, and sandwich fumble! Ball loose at the 35. The player's still fighting for possession of the ball, and the officials have not given an indication at this point. Columbia says it's our ball, but the officials haven't made that determination.
Well, Jim Salters popped out of the with the ball in his hand. I think that the referees are still looking to see who actually had the ball, but Salters popped up so quick, I think it fooled everyone.
It's Princeton football at the 35. It's been a tough first half for Damani Leach holding on to the ball. Here it is.
Not much you can say about this. Good blocking on the part of Princeton. Damani cuts up field. He heads up north, doing a good job with the return, but again, he doesn't take care holding that ball.
How did Columbia not get that ball? That's a that's a tough one. Tigers get a break at the 35. Here's the pitch. Girado looks to get outside, and he puts his head down and picks up a couple of yards across the 35 up to the 37-yard line. They'll bring a second down and 7 for the Tigers.
Lou, that's just good power blocking on the part of right tackle Steve Lamberton and tight end number 89 Jason Glotzback. Joe Susan's been particularly happy with the development of Lamberton, a junior at a Winmore, Pennsylvania. He's made tremendous strides both personally and athletically.
Look at that stat. Princeton has played well when the sun shines, but not well on days like today. 0-2, both losses, Cornell and Harvard, of course. McKelney rolls out, fires incomplete. Well, you can't blame that one on the Princeton quarterback. He had his receiver at the 49. Ray Canole tried to cut back to the ball. Canole with 22 receptions on the season coming in.
That was a very nice pass, thrown right on the money to a curling Ray Canole. It hit him right between the numbers, Lou. He dropped it.
Third down coming up for Princeton. The Tigers have not been successful on third downs today. They're 0-for-5 in this first half. Twin receivers roll out to the left side, and McKelney drops back in the shotgun. He looks to throw. Steps up, fires, incomplete, in between two defenders at the 45 for Jerry Girado. And the Tigers will have to punt.
Well, here we see Harry McKelney stepping back. Can't blame him on this series. He's thrown two balls right on the money, one to Canole and one to Girado, and his two receivers have just dropped perfectly thrown balls, Lou.
McKelney 2-for-9, no yards, one interception here in this first half. Evans gets the kick away. It bounces out of bounds at about the 40, and Columbia will have excellent field position one more time. Columbia really has had the better of the field position here in this first half. But the Princeton defense keeping the Tigers in the game, keeping the Lions off the scoreboard, more importantly.
Well, they've been the beneficiary of a number of turnovers, and Princeton's been lucky actually to hold on to a few fumbled balls today, Lou.
I formation for the Lions as they come up to the line of scrimmage. Columbia with a first and at their own 40-yard line. 7:13 remaining second quarter. Here's the handoff. It goes up the middle to Norman Hayes, and he gets across the 45 to the 46-yard line. The sophomore getting the start at tailback. He shows some pretty good acceleration.
He sure does. Very interesting. He's filling in for John Toy, who's filling in for Jason Bivens. And he's still putting in a darn good performance. That's, you know, a great job of recruiting on the part of Columbia's offensive coaches.
Ray Tellier, in his 13th year. Columbia is the head man, actually his 13th year overall. Last year, Division I AA Coach of the Year came to Columbia in 1989. Handoff across the 45 to the 46. No gain on that play.
Smothered by Mark Whaling and Griff King. Whaling's an interesting player. I mean, he plays with incredible fire. I was just talking to defensive line coach Steve DiGregorio before the game. He said he's his favorite player of all time that he's coached. His engine is going all the time. Plays with incredible energy and drive. He's not real big. He plays at about 230, but man, is he quick.
39 tackles coming in to this game. Play action. Thomason all day to throw. No pass rush to speak of. And the pass is incomplete. Intended for Burt Bondi, who really, actually it wasn't Bondi, it was Norman Hayes at the 50-yard line. He was hit hard by Tim Green. And again, the Princeton defense does the job.
Princeton's got some outstanding defensive backs. I mean, maybe we haven't talked about it enough, but Damani Leach, Tommy Ludwig, Ryan Demler, and again, Jerry Wilson do a tremendous job. Thomason had very good protection, but Princeton had outstanding coverage. Timmy Green just pummeled Norman Hayes right when he touched the ball.
Tommy Ludwig there on the play as well. Ludwig, 45 tackles coming in. Again, Princeton with a big rush, but it's a booming kick and goes into the end zone. The Tigers will take it at the 20-yard line, and the rain really coming down now here with 5 minutes and 40 seconds remaining in the second quarter. I mean, it is absolutely pouring out there.
Yeah, this is these are not the conditions that one would really want to play in. As a defender, it was sort of fun slopping around in the mud and the rain a little bit, but on offense, it's tough to get the motor running when you have this gale force wind and driving rain. It's like you wish you had some windshield wipers out there on your helmet.
First and 10, Princeton at the 20-yard line. Harry McKelney comes up under center, and the Tigers shift in the backfield. Hand off, Damian Taylor up the middle. Breaks a tackle across the 25-yard line. One of the more successful running plays of the afternoon for Princeton.
Excellent job by the two pulling linemen of Princeton, number 57, Hameen Abdullah, number 72, left tackle, Jeff Bennett. As we watch it here, we see counter action. We see Taylor taking a jab step to the left, and two mammoth Princeton offensive linemen doing a great job leading the way, providing a convoy for Taylor, good for a 6-yard gain.
Second and 4. McKelney gives to Taylor again. Another huge hole up the middle. Puts his head down. He has a Princeton first down across the 30 and up to the 32-yard line. Well, another big hole that time. Two plays in a row for the Tigers.
Well, we see the same play to the left side of scrimmage. This time it's number 68, Brian Herdman, number 74, right tackle Steve Lamberton, leading the way for Taylor again. This is precisely what offensive coordinator Joe Susan hoped to do. We see the two big offensive linemen coming across, they're leading the way. We see a huge hole open up, and Taylor just doing what he's supposed to, following the big guys for a nice gain.
Taylor again carries the football, this time across 35, up the 37-yard line.
Taylor, an interesting story, Lou. He missed all of 1996 with a very, very difficult knee injury. And the coaches say that he still hasn't fully recovered, but he's really doing a nice job today. As a senior, this guy scored 24 touchdowns for a state championship team in Virginia.
Sophomore came in with 213 yards on the ground, gets the carry again, breaks a tackle up the middle, and he's close to another Princeton first down. Well, Taylor's doing a good job of finding the hole. Did a good job there, Pete, of kind of stopping himself and then looking ahead to find the hole and scoot it through.
This counter is meant to go off tackler in the guard tackle gap. Taylor cuts it back all the way to the other side of the line of scrimmage. Shows a great job of reading the defensive and offensive line, and again, he gets close to first down, Lou.
Third down and one for the Tigers. They have not been successful. Third down conversions here this afternoon. A big one here. McKelney keeps it and then dives ahead. Looked like they were running a little bit of option, and McKelney kept it himself, dove ahead. That should be enough for a Princeton first down.
Princeton's first sustained drive of the afternoon. This should serve to give them some confidence. They just need to keep it going here, Lou.
3 minutes and 15 seconds remaining second quarter. And the Tigers have the football at the 43-yard line. It's a first and 10 for Princeton. Head coach Steve Toshis of Princeton, what a job he's done with the Tigers in this 11th year.
68 wins, just 36 losses.
Three Ivy League titles.
Taylor banged down hard at the line of scrimmage that time. No chance to get the motor going.
That was a nice play by number 44, Paul Rowland. He's a junior linebacker out of Williamsville, New York. The counter, they run counter again. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. Keep running until they learn how to stop it. But it's a relatively easy read for the linebacker once you get used to making the jab step with the running back, and then you'll see full flow from offensive linemen coming across your face, and then you follow them, and it should lead you to the ball.
Twin receivers left side. McKelney fires incomplete at the 48-yard line, intended for Ken Navarez.
Dangerous pass, Lou. Michele Blanco was right there. That ball's thrown a little bit lower. That's six the other direction.
So now third and 10 for Princeton. Tigers in a tough situation. They just have not been able to respond over the last 2 weeks in situations like this. On third and 10, receivers split. Twin receivers to the left side, a single receiver to the right. McKelney goes back, sets it up. Taylor smashed, absolutely pummeled. No chance on the play. Jeremy Taylor, the junior middle linebacker, he read it all the way. 64 tackles coming in, 38 of them solo. You can see why.
Well, there's nowhere to go on that play. Columbia ran a blitz on that play. It was picked up nicely by the Princeton running backs as we watch in slow motion here. Kelly drops back. He sells the pass well to the left side, wheels to his right, tries to get the ball to Taylor, but he's there, and he's hit right now by number 31, Jeremy Taylor. Honorable mention, all Ivy linebacker in 1996.
So with 2:04 remaining here, Princeton will punt. Columbia will get the football, and the Lions are thinking, hey, we've got enough time to try to get something on the board. There's a nice panoramic shot. Not a very nice day, but you sort of get the idea here.
Well, that view, Lou, is one of the reasons why Sports Illustrated named Lawrence Wien Stadium one of the most scenic stadiums in the country to watch a football game. We were at what's called Spuyten Duyvel. Don't ask me to spell it.
His punt goes inside the 10. I mean, Evans is just unbelievable. Another great punt by Evans. That's his eighth punt inside the 20-yard line. 61 yards on the kick for Matt Evans. He also has had a 63-yarder this year.
It's been outstanding all year. Last year, he set school records for number of punts and averages. Average yard per punt at 40.7. That was a school record. And this year, he leads the Ivy League in punting, Lou. He's a real weapon, and he's an asset to the defense.
Well, now Columbia with a minute 50 left, is back at their own 5-yard line. So Ray Tellier's got to be thinking, let's just not make any mistake and give Princeton some points here.
Precisely.
Handoff goes off tackle across the 5 up to the 6 or 7-yard line. He's on the carry. And Princeton calls the timeout. Tigers are thinking they'd like to get the ball back with a minute 42 remaining. That gives us an opportunity to tell you that this telecast of Princeton University football is sponsored in part by McCaffrey's Supermarkets. McCaffrey's, when they say fresh baked, they mean fresh. Baked from scratch by their talented professional bakers and pastry chefs right in their stores. McCaffrey's Supermarkets offer a wide variety of gourmet cakes, pastries, and breads. McCaffrey's, a supermarket experience in Princeton, West Windsor, and Yardley, Pennsylvania.
Man, you're making me hungry, Lou.
Well, we are getting towards halftime, I'm sure. We'll have to try to find some food, right?
Some McCaffrey's pastries.
Yeah. Well, Columbia and Princeton no score with a minute 42 remaining in the first half. This game very similar to the game that Princeton played last week against Harvard. A very low scoring affair. Handoff goes to Hayes up the middle. He's hit and dropped at the 10-yard line. Princeton all over that play.
Tommy Ludwig on the tackle. Running back was slowed down prior to that by number 94, Big Griff King.
Tigers call another timeout. Here's an interesting offensive stat. Hayes, the outstanding tailback for Columbia, Norman Hayes with 34 yards rushing so far in the first half. Princeton as a team has 27, so Hayes has more than the entire Tiger squad. Princeton has not put up very good offensive numbers in this first half.
Well, if you're an offensive coach or a head coach at Princeton, you got to be scratching your head right now. Very disappointing after what was a very poor performance last week up at Harvard.
Well, Princeton's thinking they want to get the football back. They take a timeout. They'll have one left, actually, with a minute 33 remaining. It's a third down and 5. And if Columbia doesn't pick up the first down here, they may take that timeout and force the Lions to punt.
Well, smart play calling on the part of head coach Steve Tosches. I mean, he's given his team an opportunity to put some points on the board, which is what they need to do. Maybe we get a punt block. We'll see.
Hayes trying to get outside, takes on a couple of tacklers, and gets out of bounds at about the 12-yard line or so. That's not exactly what he wanted to do, because by running out of bounds, well, now Princeton takes a timeout. So they say he didn't get out of bounds? I don't understand that. Looked like he was forced out of bounds. And if so, there was no need for Princeton to take a timeout.
Very puzzling, much like this week's episode of The X-Files. I'm not sure exactly what's going on there. But actually, it was a very good job on the part of number 21, Justin Medlin, a sophomore defensive back who did a great job bringing the play out, preventing Columbia running back from turning the corner and getting upfield. But again, Princeton forced to use another timeout. The minute 19, they hope to get some offense going here late in the second quarter.
Tigers will get the football around midfield. Doesn't get any different for the Princeton defense. You can see that their next four opponents giving up 299 yards a game, averaging 299 yards a game. Princeton's last three averaged nearly 460 yards, 458 to be precise. So Princeton, as we said, has had to go up against some tough offensive teams over the last several weeks. High end-over-end kick. Damani Leach has it and holds on, this time at the 40-yard line.
All right, he holds that one. Way to go, Damani.
Princeton has the football at the 39-yard line, a minute 12 remaining and no timeouts left. So the Tigers will go into a two-minute offense. A couple of weeks ago, Princeton looked spectacular on offense against Colgate. In the waning moments of the game, Harry McKelney led the Tigers down the field against Colgate to pull the football game out.
Well, McKinley's was described to me by Princeton coaches as a streaky quarterback. He looked like a pro against Colgate and looked like a Pop Warner quarterback versus Harvard. I hate to be so harsh, but it was a very difficult game for Harry. And as we watch him roll out in waggle action,
he just throws that one way over the head of his intended receiver, Ray Canole. The coverage was offered by Dominic Reebley, a senior, strong safety, and it brings up second and 10.
Columbia in a nickel package. Reebley's the nickelback. McKinley thrown right into the teeth of the wind. What's going to be really critical, Lou, is how Princeton starts off the third quarter, because they should be playing with the wind. It's going to be very difficult to get anything going right now in this last minute and 5 seconds into this very stiff gale force wind.
McKinley in the shotgun, looks to throw, steps up, fires, intercepted. Off the hands of the receiver and picked off by Dalton. He's at the 35 to the 30. One man to beat. He's inside the 10-yard line. Columbia with a great break. The pass went off in the hands of the receiver, and Hasheem Dalton, the junior strong safety, ran it back inside the 10-yard line. Columbia has a first and goal.
Lou, hindsight's always 20-20, but looking at this pass into the wind, hits Canole right in the hands, and unfortunately for Princeton, it then pops into the hands of number 12, Hasheem Dalton. He makes an excellent run. He shows great speed. He gets some good blocking by number 44, linebacker Paul Rowland, the Olay block.
Columbia, first down and goal at the 7-yard line. Out of the I formation, give to Hayes. Hit at the line of scrimmage and driven back. Might have picked up a yard. 44 seconds remaining. Columbia does have two timeouts left. You go back to that pass for a second. That's going to show up as an interception under Harry McKelney's stats. But that pass should have been caught, Pete Milano. That was right in the hands of the receiver.
There's no question about it. I mean, you can't put any blame on the quarterback on that play. These receivers, these Princeton receivers, have to start holding on to the ball.
Now Columbia will have a second and goal at about the 5-yard line with 43 seconds remaining. Lions certainly have a great opportunity to get points out of this, even if they don't get the ball in the end zone. This would be a chip shot field goal from here.
Well, let's see if the Princeton defense can answer the call one more time. Very dejected player on the sidelines for Princeton. There's not much to be happy about if you're a Princeton player right now. What you should feel fortunate about is that you're not down by more.
No score with 40 left here in the second. Oh, Columbia 3, excuse me, Princeton nothing. Columbia 3, Princeton nothing. Remember the field goal kicked by Kravitz. Thomason throws, catch made, touchdown Columbia. Beautifully executed play. Lendale Thompson, the fullback, coming out of the backfield, and Thomason delivered it beautifully.
Not a fancy play, a very conservative play, Lou. Off of play action, as you mentioned, the fullback, number 18, Lendale Thompson, just going into the flat. Princeton defender late to get over. The ball's delivered softly. Touchdown, Columbia. Princeton about to go down 10-0.
Kravitz is in to kick the extra point. The kick is up. It is good. So with 37 seconds remaining, second quarter, it's Columbia 10 and Princeton nothing.
Lou, I talked about in the opening how important it would be to see how Princeton reacts after a very difficult loss to Harvard. It doesn't appear that they've reacted very well. This has been a less than spirited effort on the part of Princeton's offense and even their defense to some degree, although they've been put in very difficult positions. This is exactly what Coach Tosches, this is a Halloween nightmare, if you would, for Coach Tosches. You watch Thomason on this replay deliver a ball very softly to the fullback, Damani Leach, late in getting over. Looked like a blown assignment. Good for six.
Well, 10-0 Columbia, that interception really hurting the Tigers as Columbia was set up with a first and goal and the Lions cashed in.
Lou, if I'm Princeton here, I field the ball and I just did it. Out of this half, I try and regroup. I go into the halftime and we're going to have a little soul searching probably on the part of the Princeton offense and defense. I would not want to be a Princeton player right now as they go into halftime down 10-0.
Short kick, and it's returned to the 30-yard line. Columbia 10, Princeton nothing, with 31 seconds remaining.
Head coach, Columbia head coach Ray Tellier deserves some credit here, Lou. He's done a remarkable job in turning this program around. He's established a sense of legitimacy to a Columbia program. Before he arrived in the decade of the 80s, went 7-91-2.
The Lions seem to be playing better, as we mentioned. Last week, the win over Yale. Handoff goes up the middle to the 35. Jerry Girado carries the football. 20 seconds counting down in this first half. And Columbia has a 10-0 lead. The Lions looking to go in to halftime in pretty good shape.
Well, Lou, no matter how good your defense plays, if you don't score points, you ain't going to win, right? The best you can hope for is a tie.
That's right. And, of course, Princeton, if they don't score points, they'll lose today. It is 10-0 Columbia at the half. You're watching Princeton Tigers football on RCN Channel 8 Sports. Welcome back to Baker Field here in New York City, site of today's Ivy League clash between Columbia and Princeton. The Lions lead the Tigers 10-0 as we get ready for the second half of football. Lou Brognall along with former Princeton linebacker Pete Milano alongside. Glad you could join us for RCN's coverage of Princeton football. Not a good first half, Pete, for the Tigers. Let's face it, offensively, they did very, very little. The defense did another stellar job, but when you're constantly put in a situation where your back's up against the wall, boy, it gets awfully tough, doesn't it?
It sure does. It's difficult to game plan weather, and these are about as adverse rain conditions, conditions that you can play football in. And as we look here at the less than stellar stats, Lou, Princeton has not scored 10-0, only 3 first downs, a total of 5 first downs between both teams, and a total of some 65 yards combined total offense. If you can believe it, Princeton's outgained Columbia.
The key stats there, turnovers, of course. 3 big turnovers for Princeton, none bigger than the interception return at the end of the second quarter.
Well, Princeton coming into this game was number 2 in the Ivies in turnover margin at +6. And obviously when you lose 3 turnovers in these type of conditions, gives an offense a heck of an opportunity to score. Princeton defense not done a poor job, but again, Columbia is able to score a field goal off a Damani Leach fumble and then a touchdown after a 47-yard return by Hashim Dalton.
It is a driving rain as we get ready for the second half, a driving, cold, windy rain, and Columbia will kick it off right to left on your screen. Princeton needs to do something on offense here at the beginning of the third quarter. Damani Leach at the 10 to the 20, 25, puts his head down. Princeton will put it in play there at the 27-yard line. Give you an idea of how tough a first half it was for the Princeton offense. First half possessions, 5 punts, 2 interceptions, 1 given up on downs, and of course, the end of the half as well.
Less than stellar, to say the least, Lou. And I was mistaken. I thought Princeton would be leading off by actually going with the wind. It appears that they're going to be going into the wind here in the third quarter.
Harry Nikelny brings the Tigers out, first down and 10 at the 28-yard line. Bruce Herb goes in motion and a give up the middle. Damian Taylor slammed down. Nothing doing. A big wall of blue jerseys there. Columbia, led by Jim Armstrong, makes the tackle. No gain on play. In fact, they lost a yard. It'll be second and 11.
What Armstrong was able to do is actually cut underneath the pulling tackle and guard on the left side of Princeton's line of scrimmage. He's been very active today, Lou. We've called his name out three or four times today.
Just underway third quarter. Princeton comes up with a second down and 11 at the 26-yard line. McKelney looks at his twin receiver split to the left side, and Harry flips it to Damian Taylor, who picks up a cut. He gets back to the original line of scrimmage, perhaps, and now it's third down and long.
Very perilous situation for an offensive coach here. In this type of rain, a defensive coach could almost eliminate the possibility of passing. You can really play real solid run defense. You can stack the line of scrimmage. That's what they did on this play. They tried to run off tackle, but they gained not a yard on that play.
Saw the shot of the driving rain here at Columbia. McKelney looks to throw, steps up, fires incomplete, bounces it at the 4-yard line, and the Tigers will have to punt. So the second half begins pretty much as the first half went for the Princeton offense.
Lou, it's going to come down to who's can score going with the wind. It's going to be almost impossible, in my opinion, to score without the help of a turnover trying to go into this very strong wind. There was good protection on that play. McKelney had time. He had clear throwing lanes, but the batted down by the wind.
Look at Evans trying to kick into that wind. Unbelievable. And Evans, an outstanding kicker, averaging 43 yards a punt.
Yeah, we're talking about one of the leading punters in the nation. Absolutely ineffectual against this wind.
That punt, 12 yards for Matt Evans.
Not good for the average.
Ball is at the 40-yard line. And Columbia in business here. Great field position to begin their initial possession of the second half.
Fourth quarter will be crucial for Princeton's offense, Lou.
Lions come up in the I formation. Receiver split left and right. Bobby Thomason, the senior quarterback, hands the ball off. Off tackle, right side.
Norman Hayes with a good job scampering, making 2 yards out of what appeared to be nothing. The left side of the Princeton defensive line, Mark and Griff King, did a good job in holding their ground. It was only good for a short gain of 3 yards.
Brings up a second down and 7. Ball sits at the 37-yard line. Twin receivers come left side. Now man goes in motion. That's the fullback, Lendell Thompson. Handoff goes to Hayes, trying to get around that corner, looking for a block, and Princeton strings it out beautifully. Good job by the Tigers. Ryan Demler comes over to finally make the tackle. Demler, an interesting story, a converted quarterback, now the sophomore free safety, and he's taken the starting job away from Brett Marshall.
Just a simple off-tackle play, an excellent job on the part of Columbia's left side of their offensive line, led by big number 55, Jay DePertis. They're able to hook the Princeton defenders and actually drive them off the line of scrimmage. Hayes had a lot of room to run there. It's going to be a long afternoon for Princeton if Columbia can continue to run in that manner.
It's close to a Columbia first down, and the officials will stretch out the sticks as they measure. It is just shy by about a half a yard, so Columbia will have third down.
You mentioned Demler before, Lou, number 22, a converted quarterback. He was perhaps the biggest surprise on the part of the defense. Each of the defensive coaches mentioned him as being his emergence as a real quality free safety as being the biggest surprise on defense thus far in the season.
Columbia comes up to the line of scrimmage, third down, less than a yard at the 30-yard line.
Look for a sneak here.
Bobby Thomason stretches over tackle. He's got the first down by plenty. Thomason, 6'2", 205, and with that excellent size, he just stretches out behind the block on the left side of the left tackle, Jay DuPurchase, and the left guard, Marcel Deans.
He's run for over 100 yards this season, Lou, and the Princeton coaches were extremely worried about Thomason's ability to run, both from the bootleg and rollout, as well as finding a crease after dropping back to pass.
First and 10, Columbia, the Lions, at the Princeton 28-yard line. Out of the I formation, the give is to Hayes. Up the middle, not much there. Tigers play it well defensively. Griff King in on the tackle along with Jamie Toddings. No gain on the play. And Columbia looking at second and 10. 3 minutes gone by in the third quarter at rain-soaked Baker Field. Rain really coming down. It's been raining throughout the game. It really has started raining hard from about the middle of the second quarter on. Lions come up in the eye with a second down and 9. Hand off Hayes, and he's down near the 21-yard line where he's banged down by Demler.
Again, excellent run blocking on the part of Columbia's left side of the offensive line. Number 55, Jay DePertis, captain. It's called Columbia's best offensive lineman by Princeton's defensive coordinator, Steve Verbit. Nothing fancy, Lou. They're maintaining possession. Their linemen are getting a good jump off the ball. They're driving Princeton defenders. Here we see the fullback get a nice block on a charging Jamie Toddings. And Norman Hayes able to turn the corner.
Third down and call it 2. For Columbia, the give to Hayes. Off tackle, slips through. He was hit behind the line of scrimmage, but was able to slither through. And he gets close to first down yardage. He may be about a buck short.
Well, Mark Whaling, number 51, the left tackle for Princeton, did a nice job in fending off his block. Piece of Norman Hayes, but Hayes showing remarkable durability for someone who's only 5'8", 190. He's able to break the tackle of Whaling, get pretty darn close to a first down.
Now it's a fourth down and 1 at the 19-yard line. Columbia calls timeout with 10 minutes and 13 seconds remaining here in the third quarter. Well, Columbia and Princeton, the 67th meeting. First time these two teams played, 1874. Tigers won, 6-0. Princeton leads this all-time series, 54 wins to 11 wins for Columbia. But the Tigers have won 5 of the last 6 meetings between the two teams.
The safety that Harvard scored last week, as you see on the screen, with the first third quarter points allowed by the Tigers in 97, but Columbia's knocking on the door right here, Lou, since allowed 2 third quarter points all year long. But with Columbia here on the 18-yard line, they may be giving up some more.
Here's an interesting stat, too. Love these useless stats. The last 6 meetings, the team with the worst record has won between Columbia and Princeton. If that is true, then Columbia, with a 10-0 lead, would be in great shape today. Pass, Thomason, beautiful play to Bondi, touchdown Columbia. Tremendous execution. Thomason faked the handoff to Hayes, who was hit behind the line of scrimmage, and Thomason kept the ball on his hip, threw the ball to Bondi, was wide open. That was a gorgeous play by Columbia.
Well, I tell you, I was completely fooled. I thought that the play was stopped in the backfield. I thought the ball was handed off to Hayes. Excellent play by a veteran quarterback, Bobby Thomason. He rolled off to the right outside the tackle box. He hit Bert Bondi, his favorite target, in the flat.
And the kick is up by Kiernan. Excuse me, by Kravitz. Neil Kravitz with the extra point. 7 plays, 40 yards, 3 minutes, 18 seconds. Columbia, 17. Princeton, nothing, with 10:07 left in the third.
Well, Luke, quite a juxtaposition. Columbia doing to Princeton what they were able to do to Columbia last year. Last year, Columbia by far the more dominant team. This year, Princeton the more dominant team. As we watch the replay, Bert Bondy comes clear after a tremendous run fake on part of Bobby Thomason. He froze the Princeton defenders, leaving Bondy wide open for Columbia's second touchdown of the afternoon.
Bondy, the junior, started at fullback last year for Columbia. Did an outstanding job with a lot of receptions out of the backfield, so they thought because of his pass receiving ability, they would utilize him as a receiver, and he's moved over to tight end.
Well, he played a little H-back last year, lined up in the slot a lot, and that's what they do with him. They don't often line him up on the line of scrimmage. He's not a great blocker, but he is a fantastic receiver. Coming into the game, he had 26 catches for 144 yards, about 13.2 yards a catch.
High kick to Monty Leach at the 5, to the 10, 15, 20, and he's nailed there, down at the 22-yard line. Princeton will put it in play. The Tigers are down 17-0, and they are in a bit of trouble right here.
Dire straits, I would call it. We got Lenny Kravitz's brother, the kicker, Ryan Kravitz, and then we got dire straits.
Pete Milano pulling them all out today on a first and 10 at the 22. Split backs behind Nekelny. Harry back to throw. He looks over the middle, incomplete. Line of scrimmage, but I'm not sure intended for the fullback, Mike Clifford. Clifford with 11 receptions on the season coming out of the backfield for the Tigers.
If you're a Columbia defensive coordinator here, you could just bank on the fact that Princeton's going to have to run the ball. You can let them pass, but passing is almost ineffective in this type of weather, as you can see. On that play, the Columbia defensive lineman did a great job of keeping their hands up and knocking down Harry Nekelny's pass.
Nekelny, play action, rolls out. Now he runs out of the pocket. At the 20, 25, puts his head down and gets across the 25-yard line up to the 27. Nekelny picks up some yardage, about 5 on the play.
Excellent play on the part of Nekelny. Decent protection on the part of Princeton's offensive line. Nekelny's flush and he finds a seam and shows some decent speed as he breaks to the outside and dives ahead for extra yardage.
Third down and about 5.5 or so to go for the Tigers. Nekelny looks to throw, fires, catch made. Over the middle, Jerry Girado coming out of the backfield, makes the catch. That time he did hang on to the football. It's a first down for Princeton at the Tigers' 37-yard line.
Well, for once, one of the Princeton receivers holds onto the ball. Very simple crossing route. Girado comes out of the backfield. He's matched up with number 58, linebacker Kevin Wright. That's a mismatch by any stretch of the imagination. Girado hauls in the pass, good for a first down.
First and 10, Tigers at their own 38-yard line with split backs behind Nekelny. He hands the ball off to Girado, looking for a couple of blockers. He does manage to scoot ahead across the 40 and up near the 43. That's a pickup of about 4 on the play. It'll bring up a 2nd and 6 for Princeton.
Girado with 2. That was a draw, but way through the
ball marked at about the 43-yard line. As Clifford goes in motion, Nekelny hands to Taylor, breaks a tackle, but in trouble, no chance. Columbia comes up and penetrates beautifully. Paul Rowland and Chris Tillotson combine on the tackle for the Lions.
As we watch the replay, Lou, what starts that play and makes the play is an aggressive defensive call on the part of Columbia's defensive coordinator. They sent an inside linebacker plugging up an inside hole. That play was meant to go in the interior of the line. It was bounced outside, and the Columbia players did a great job of stringing it out.
Loss of 2 on the play, so it's 3rd down and 8 for Princeton as Nekelny goes back in the shotgun, fires incomplete at the 45-yard line. throwing into coverage intended for Philip Wendler. But the Tigers drive stalls, and Princeton again will have to punt the football away.
We'll do a play that's a routine play when the conditions are normal becomes close to impossible in this type of weather. That was a in pattern that was open, but McKinley couldn't get the ball there.
Evans does a good job to get that away into the wind. The kick is touched by Hanks, and then he just takes it out of bounds at about the 30-yard line. 7:04 remaining third quarter. Columbia 17 and Princeton nothing.
Well, over the years, Lou, Columbia has made a habit of wreaking havoc on Princeton. As you may recall, let's take a look at the replay for a moment. Evans does a great job after bobbling the ball to get rid of that punt, but Princeton has been victimized by Columbia a number of times in the past, Lou. In 1988, probably the most memorable, when Columbia snapped a winless streak of 47 against Princeton, winning 16-13.
Getting outside is Hayes. He's at the 45, cuts it across the 50, and into Princeton territory at the 47-yard line. Norman Hayes showing some good speed around the corner, just a sophomore.
Shoddy tackling in the part of Princeton's defense. That's something that we haven't seen all year long. Columbia's had great success running this off tackle, either a kickout block or just a lead block. Nothing in the middle, and you see Hayes bounce it outside. See one, two missed tackles, one by Ludwig. Hayes running hard, running like a big man.
25-yard gain for Hayes, has the football again. This time he's met and dropped at the line of scrimmage. Tried to cut back against the grain. David Ferrara in on the tackle, along with, looked like Dan, no, actually Jim Salters, the middle linebacker for the Tigers. So second down and eight coming up for Columbia.
An ideal game from the standpoint of a Columbia coach. Weather conditions that might offset any difference in talent, and just real good execution and smart play.
Hand off. Hayes runs into a wall of Tigers at the 43.
Look to be Mark Whaling and David Ferrara again on that play. However, what you're starting to see is the defensive coaches, Don Dobbs and defensive coordinator Steve Verbit, starting to take some chances. They seem to be sending players either on run blitzes or pass blitzes almost on every down. They need to make something happen on defense, Lou.
Third down and eight for Columbia. The Lions are at the Princeton 44-yard line. Twin receivers, left side pass is intercepted. Picked off at the 40-yard line and on his way at the 50. Breaking a tackle is Ludwig, and he's down near the 30-yard line. Tom Ludwig, his fifth interception of the season. Off the deflection.
You talk about making something happen. That's a big-time interception. I hate to keep hounding on the fact of the conditions here, but these are wet, windy conditions. Ball bounces off the Columbia's number 25, Chris Tillotson. Ludwig makes a one-handed interception in the rain, in the driving wind, and makes a heck of a return here. He almost goes all the way. He's got one man to beat. He's dragged down by, I think, Jay DePertis, captain number 55.
Here's the pitch to Taylor. He's got a huge hole, and he's across the 25, down near the 24-yard line. Well, if you're a Princeton fan, critical drive here now. The turnover in Columbia territory, and trailing 17-0. They have to put the ball in the end zone.
You got to do it now. We're running out of time. 4:42 left here in the third quarter. You got your best field position of the afternoon. You got to at least come away with three, and you probably need a touchdown.
Receiver splits out to the right side. Here's the pitch to Taylor. 25, spins, and he's down to the 20-yard line before he's gang-tackled at that point. Princeton offensive line seems to be firing off the ball with a little more urgency now.
Well, they need a little sense of urgency. This game is about to slip through their hands. They had a huge momentum swing. The line seems to be doing well. Two consecutive plays off tackle. Taylor doing a nice job following his blockers. Let's watch this play. We should see a very nice block on the part of right tackle Steve Lamberton and a nice kickout block by number 38, Mike Clifford. Taylor running hard, keeping the ball down, protecting it, surging ahead for a first down.
First and 10, Tigers at the 20 line. McKelney calls the signals. I formation. Fakes the handoff to the fullback Clifford, keeps it himself on the option, and McKelney running some option is down inside the 15-yard line. So Princeton putting together a nice drive here with 3 minutes and 45 seconds remaining in the third quarter. Columbia with a 17-0 lead.
That was a very, very well-run option, and the left side of Princeton's offensive line caved in Columbia's defense. McKelney was able to turn the corner for a good gainer.
Taylor running hard, and he dives down near the 10-yard line. Brought down at the 11 by Hasheem Dalton, the strong safety. Taylor about a yard short of first down yardage, so it'll be third and one. Princeton at the 11-yard line. Approaching the 3-minute mark in the third quarter. To Taylor, and he dives over left tackle, and he should have enough for the first down. It is a first and goal for the Tigers.
That's a great individual effort on the part of number 32, Damian Taylor. He was hit at the line of scrimmage. If he went down after that hit, he would not have had a first down. He shook it off, fell forward. First and goal, Princeton.
Movement by the left side of the Tigers offensive line. Looked like big Justin Bennett, the left tackle. That, of course, will back Princeton up. It is a legal procedure, 5-yard penalty. So now instead of a first and goal at the 9, you're looking at a first and goal at the 14-yard line.
The costly turnover at what I'd like to call an unforced error. Too many of those, and you don't stand a chance at winning, particularly at this critical juncture in the ball game.
The pitch to Taylor, off tackle, cuts it outside at the 10. He's inside the 10 and down near the 8-yard line. Damian Taylor with a strong run, and he gets back to about the original line of scrimmage.
Damian Taylor playing like a veteran, running real hard, breaking tackles. Offensive linemen love running backs like that, Lou. They love, obviously, when they open up holes, but when a back makes extra yardage, it just makes them look good, and that's what Taylor's been doing.
2 minutes and 10 seconds remaining in the third quarter. McKelney play action, back to throw. Steps up in the pocket, fires, catch made. Ken Navaris makes the reception inside the 5-yard line. So now it'll be a third and goal from about the 3.
Off a play action pass, we see Harry McKelney well protected. He steps up in the pocket, finds Navaris, number 80, on a crossing pattern. That's his 7th catch of the year, and a big one, perhaps his biggest.
Third and goal at the 3-yard line. Full house backfield for the Tigers. As McKelney calls the signals, he gives to Gerardo, and he's not going to get there. He tried to go off tackle, might have gotten to the 2-yard line, and that's about it. Good surge by the Columbia defense. Tony McGill, backup defensive end, made the tackle. So now Princeton, as the clock winds down here in the third quarter, less than a minute left, faced with a 4th and goal from the 2, and the Tigers will disdain the field goal. They will go for it on 4th and 2.
Gutsy call, but one that I agree with. Every scoring opportunity you have to try and take advantage of under these weather conditions.
Now, Columbia looks like they may have taken a timeout. Let's see. And indeed they have. So Columbia calls a timeout with 35 seconds remaining here in the third quarter. This telecast of Princeton University football is sponsored by McCaffrey Supermarkets. McCaffrey's in the business of satisfying customers. In fact, McCaffrey's guarantees the highest quality in everything they offer. Market fresh fruits and vegetables, oven fresh baked breads, pastries, cakes, and gourmet prepared meals ready to heat and eat. McCaffrey's, a supermarket experience in Princeton, West Windsor, and Yardley, Pennsylvania.
Lou, in every game, we announcers look for a defining moment. And if there ever was one in this game, it's right now.
There's Alex Sirk. Now, he is warming up on the sidelines, but I'm pretty sure that Princeton's going to go for it here on fourth down. Sirk last week, 36-yard field goal. That broke the record for consecutive field goals in Princeton history. But the Tigers will line up here to go forward on fourth down. McKelney rolls out, left side, goes back to the right, throws, it's caught, touchdown. No, he dropped it, incomplete. Intended for the tight end, Jason Glotzback, and he could not hang on. Looked like he caught it when he first went down.
What a heartbreaking play, Lou. That was just very well executed. With the exception of the last moment of the play, it's a great call on the part of Steve Tosches. We see full action going to the left. Harry McKelney rolls out behind the left tackle box. He throws out back across his body to number, looked like 89, Jason Glotzback. It floated up in the air and dropped out of his hands. Just a devastating, devastating turn of events here.
And Glotzback coming in with four careers, but two of those were for touchdowns. Unfortunately, couldn't hang on there. Columbia takes a timeout with 12 seconds remaining.
Well, we had been able to call him Mr. Clutch. Now it's more like Mr. Muffler.
How do I respond to
just
that?
Just a little.
I have
we're trying to lighten things up here as a very discouraging situation for any Princeton fan. And
in the third quarter, Hayes, 86 yards, rushing 29 rushes. He has been the big offensive weapon for the Lions. Columbia comes off the field towards the sidelines. Now they run back on the field. I'm not sure exactly what Columbia is going to do. They called the timeout with the wind. Columbia is going to punt. They're going to punt on second down with the wind. Interesting call here by Ray Tellier.
Wow. I've heard of playing conservative. This takes that to a whole new level.
They have a 17-0 lead, and they have a huge win to their back. And they're looking for to play field position here, get the ball out of here. This is an interesting call. The snap is good. It's a high kick, and the wind helps out. It bounces at the 50, 45, and rolls out of bounds at the 42. And with 1 second left, Princeton gets the football back. On a second down play, Columbia kicks the ball out of there. That's an, I don't think I've ever seen that.
Lou, if you think about it, with a 17-point lead under these conditions, that's a pretty comfortable margin. You want to keep the ball as far away from your end zone as possible. And in thinking about it, it's not a bad strategy. It's a conservative strategy, but we've seen enough fumbles today that anything could happen. And you punt the ball in these type of conditions, you can punt the ball 100 yards.
Once left in the third quarter, Princeton will run a play, the handoff. Taylor breaks a tackle. And he's inside the 45 up to about the 47, and that was the last play of the third quarter. Three quarters gone by here at Baker Field. The score, Columbia 17 and Princeton nothing. You're watching Princeton Tigers football on RCN Sports.
I can't! I'm sleeping!
Hey! Give me!
What?
You ever get the feeling other shows are filming the same scenes we are?
No. Why do you say that?
Hang on, Freddy!
Hang on, Joe Cohen! Tommy, hang on!
Ready for something different? USA Network, the cure for the common show.
Again, quarter number four in a driving rainstorm here in Manhattan. Second down and five. Here's the pitch to Taylor, looking to get outside, and he's brought down at about the 42-yard line, actually the 47-yard line, a short pickup, and it will bring up third down. Lou Brogno along with Pete Milano. Glad you could join us here on RCN sports coverage of Princeton Tiger football. The Tigers came into this game holding on to Ivy League title hopes by a thread, but a loss here today would absolutely destroy those title aspirations.
Well, the odds of Princeton title are dwindling more and more as the rain continues to fall here.
McKelney with a player in his face makes the throw, and Gerardo can't make the catch. And that has been the theme all day long for Princeton. I mean, their situation, Pete, where McKelney made a terrific play under extreme duress. That pass has to be caught.
There's no question about it. Paul Rowland, number 44, coming on a inside linebacker blitz. He's been all over the field. McKelney does an unbelievable job to get rid of the ball. He puts it right in Gerardo's hands, and it falls right through.
Evans, the punt. A booming kick with the wind at his back. It goes into the end zone. A rocket.
That's unfortunate that it actually went into the end zone. It came darn close to actually going out at the 1 yard line. But that's been the way things have gone for Princeton all afternoon. Now with 14:10 to go, they're forced to try and score 17 points. It's a daunting task, Lou.
Other Ivy League score, the last score we had was at the half between Harvard and Dartmouth, and Harvard was comfortably ahead, 24-0. Harvard certainly, of course, will be in the driver's seat if that score holds up for the Ivy League title.
Certainly will.
First down 10, Columbia at the 20-yard line. The give is off tackle, and breaking outside is Norman Hayes. He's at the 45 and up near midfield. Hayes just took it to the outside, started in, then cut it out. And a big play for the Lions.
Let's watch Storm and Norman here as he starts off counter action, cuts back all the way to the right side of scrimmage. There's nothing doing on the left. Hayes outruns the Princeton defense. He's winning this game almost by himself. Almost crossed midfield for the Columbia Lions.
Hayes, 30 carries, 116 yards. Hand off. Across the 50, Hayes still on his feet, gets to about the 49-yard line. Well, right now, he might be our player of the game. What a day for him.
Outstanding day. In these type of conditions, rushing the ball for over 100 yards, particularly now, this is when they need him most. If they get some of this clock, obviously Princeton's going to stand a very slim chance of coming back.
Well, as tough as this game is for Princeton fans, they can't feel any worse than Rutgers fans do. Rutgers trailing Temple in the third, 49-7.
Not a good day for New Jersey college football.
Second down, 10. Handoff at the 50 and down to about the 47-yard line. Norman Hayes.
Ooh, I'd be very surprised if we saw another Columbia pass throughout the rest of this game.
Going against the wind, and they have a 17-0 lead. I'm sure they'll be content to keep it on the ground. These two teams have had a number of outstanding games against each other. Stutosius looks on. A lot of surprises in this series. 1961, Columbia won the Ivy League championship. Their only loss that season, Princeton. 1934, Columbia went to the Rose Bowl, beat Stanford. Lost that season, Princeton. So it's been that type of series over the years. Handoff, off tackle, running hard is Norman Hayes. I think Columbia has found themselves a tailback.
He's got some real quicks. I mean, he showed some great explosion. The hole appeared to be there just for a moment between Marcel Deans, number 78, their senior left guard, and Brian Gordon, number 79, a freshman center. He exploded through the hole into the Princeton backfield, defensive backfield, and gained a critical first down.
Columbia has a first and 10 at the Princeton 37-yard line. With 12 minutes left in the game, fumble by Thomason, jumps on the ball, fumbled the snap from center. And you do have a new center in there, of course, Brian Gordon. He's just a freshman. Chandler Bottage, sophomore center, who had been starting, is out. He had surgery on a herniated disc, so that's a very tough situation for him.
Painful.
Second down, 10.
It's just a phenomenal effort on the part of the Columbia Lions.
Hayes, by the way, has been 66% of the Columbia offense today. He's carried the ball 33 times out of 50 offensive plays, make it 34 out of 51. As he heads towards the 35-yard line, banged down at about the 36. Now it'll bring up third down.
Griff King and Timmy Green in on that tackle, as the Princeton linebackers and defensive line buckle down. Time drifting away here. Tigers' biggest enemy at this point, Lou.
You're looking at a third and 8 for Columbia. 10 minutes and 40 seconds left in the game. And the Lions already have a 17-0 lead. Here's the handoff. Hayes spins across the 35, and he's gang tackled at that point. So it'll bring up a fourth down for the Lions.
Norman Hayes out of Richmond, California. He was moved to running back after the 1996 season. He was listed as a fullback and an H-back.
Interesting you bring up California. 31% of the roster, Columbia, from the state of California. Lions draw heavily from California. A lot of that's a big chunk. I mean, 31, that's a third of your team.
Well, two players we'd be remiss in not mentioning, Rory Wolfork and Marcellus Wiley, both players that have seen some NFL experience.
That one nearly blocked. In fact, the Tigers might have gotten a piece of it about the 26-yard line, partially tipped. Let's see if we can see it.
Turnover would be big here, a big play like a punt block.
Looked like Fatizi, who got his hand on it. As usual.
Come on, let's do it. Let's give it to him. With his second of the game, Rocky Fatizi. Five for the year.
You mentioned Rory Wilfork. He was drafted by the Cardinals, had a shot with the Ravens. And Marcellus Wiley is actually playing for the Bills. Backup defensive end.
I believe he's listed as number two behind Bruce Smith.
McKelney looks to throw, floats it out. In coverage, it's incomplete. Broken up at the 40-yard line. He was going deep for Ray Canole, but he was triple covered at the 40-yard line.
Coming into the game and talking to offensive coordinator Joe Susan, they thought that they could go up top on Columbia. McKinley throws into covers, but he gives Canole a chance, to make the catch. And you need to make that play. Columbia has done a great job of making plays. Princeton has done a poor job of making plays. Harry McKelney, 5 of 21 for 8 yards.
8 yards passing. McKelney in trouble, hit and crushed at about the 17-yard line. Huge loss on the play coming in to make the play. The Lions, Paul Rowland and John Spruill, a defensive tackle, a sophomore, Rowland a junior. By the way, only 13 seniors on the team total for Columbia. This is a very young defensive squad.
Let's watch here as the Powder Blue Lions and a host of defenders come in. Again, number 31, Jeremy Taylor. We've called his name often today. doing a great job of coming on a run on a pass blitz and sacking McKelney.
Third down and about 16. McKelney play action out, in trouble, ball's loose, stripped away, picked up by McKelney. Now he just runs forward across the 20-yard line to about the 27 or so. And Princeton will have to punt it away with 8:28 left in the game.
Playing like a defeated team right now, the Tigers, Lou. As we watch Aaron McKelney back in the five-step drop, when he reaches up to throw the ball, looked like number 41, Eric Huntley, a backup defensive end, a linebacker last year, stripped him. It's fortunate McKelney was able to pick up the ball off the turf, go ahead for a few yards, but far short of the first down.
Matt Evans in punt formation. He's done a lot of that today. Gets the snap, line drive, kick. Another rocket, but a whistle before he actually let the ball go. Look at that kick. Out of the end zone it
Touchback.
Rolls. Well, around the Ivy League today, Cornell at Brown, Penn at Yale, Harvard at Dartmouth. Of course, Harvard-Dartmouth, the big game in the Ivy League today.
Lou, we got a halftime score there, as you had mentioned before. Real surprising to all of us, but 24-0 at the half.
And that game is at Dartmouth also, Pete. That is a surprising score.
Penalty on the play puts Princeton back even further.
Evans stands inside the five. Good snap. Gets it away. Another booming kick. And it is fielded by Hanks at the 40. 45. 50. Ahead of the field at the 40. Cuts it in. Still in bounds and then knocked out of bounds by the punter, Matt Evans. He forced him out of bounds at the 25. And Columbia will have a first down and 10 in Princeton territory at the 25-yard line.
Lou, Columbia doing everything right today and Princeton doing everything wrong. Had a return right on that play. We see Hanks field the ball after bobbling it. He turns a corner and there's no one around him. Evans makes a touchdown-saving tackle here, forcing him out of bounds. As I said, Columbia executing. They got momentum firmly entrenched on their side of the field.
Good defensive play by Tim Green as he got penetration and knocked down Norman Hayes. A loss of a yard. It'll be second down 11. The rain coming down in sheets now, and the lights are on here at Baker Field.
From the standpoint of the Princeton coaches, this game has been an absolute disaster. With the exception of some decent play on defense, they have failed to execute in almost every aspect of the game today.
Second down and 11, I formation, receiver split left and right. Thomason fumbles the snap and covers up at the 27. Clock ticking, 7 minutes left in the game. The ball just simply too wet at this point.
Lou, I preface my previous statement. Obviously, the weather affects the way players are able to execute, but you know, some of the bounces have gone Columbia's way, but they have not had any problem at all coming up with big plays and doing what it takes to win. So again, I, knowing that I bleed orange and black, I preface my words, but it's been a poorly executed game.
Norman Hayes carries the football, excuse me, Pete, and he's hit at the line of scrimmage.
Thanks for stopping me.
Anyway, it brings up a fourth down. Let's see what Columbia does here with a 17-0 lead. 6 minutes left in the game. Clock is winding down.
Princeton in need of at least three scores here in order to come back.
Receivers split out to the left side as Columbia will go on fourth down and 10. Thomason hands the ball off, though. And trying to sneak outside is Norman Hayes. He won't get there. And Princeton takes over on downs. The Tigers will have the football at the 23-yard line with 5 minutes and 39 seconds left in the game.
We'll give Ray Tellier all the credit in the world here. And and the players themselves self-motivating.
There are the standings. Dartmouth and Harvard on top heading into today. And of course, Harvard leading Dartmouth, so the Crimson looking to take over the top spot.
Princeton poised to fall to 1-3 in the Ivy League. Columbia moving up to 2-2.
First down and 10 at the 23-yard line. Pass is nearly picked off. Michaeli Belanca had a shot. And a new quarterback in for the Tigers, John Burnham, the junior, 6'3", 205, out of Washington, D.C. Prior to that last play, Harry McKelney had taken every snap from center for Princeton this year. Burnham did see some playing time last year for the Tigers.
And when Brett Baczynski was out with mononucleosis, terrible disease, Burnham saw some action.
Burnham breaks away, picks up some yardage across the 30-yard line to about the 33.
Such a bad illness, I can barely say it, Lou.
John Burnham, he's a junior, so he is in line, at least, to be the Princeton quarterback next year.
Nothing against his talents, but Harry McKelney is a very capable quarterback. It seems like Princeton is, in some ways, giving up here.
That pass nicely thrown by Burnham as Canole makes the catch across the 35 to the 37.
But who am I? He seems to be moving the team here.
Second down and 5 at the 39-yard line with 4 minutes and 40 seconds left. Whistle and flags. That'll be a motion penalty on the Tigers. That will do it. Well, the attendance has been announced here at the Baker Field. I think it was 1,000 and some change. I counted about 84 before, but we'll give them 1,000.
1,000 paying customers.
I counted 43, no lie, folks, on this side of the stadium. I mean, it's a nasty day. Burnham looking to throw, and he fires, catch is made at about the 37-yard line. It's a nasty day.
Number 15, Ray Canole, hauling that ball in.
Nasty day not only for football, but for just about anything that you want to do.
Princeton playing with no backs here. We see Canole run a little hitch pattern, just stops in front of the defensive back about 7 yards downfield, and it's a nice throw by Burnham.
Ball knocked loose, incomplete. 4 minutes, 15 seconds remaining.
So even short patterns, short 5-yard patterns that appear to be wide open, Arch, in this type of weather. I think there has been as many drop balls as there are people in this stadium. What do you think of that?
I think you're right. By the way, John Burnham has 10 yards passing. That's 2 more than Harry McKelney had the entire game. McKelney finished with 8 yards passing. Burnham runs out of there, cuts against the grain, and he's brought down at about the 44.
Burnham on the carry. Burnham playing with a little fire here. Up until this point, Harry McKelney has taken every snap this year, Lou.
There's a look at some of the crowd. That looks like the Princeton side. Burnham looks to throw, fires, dropped at the 47-yard line. Ball just simply dropped at that point. It'll bring up a second and 10 within 59 seconds remaining in the game. And you saw those Princeton fans. I mean, you got to really be a fan to sit there in this kind of weather and watch this game.
You know what they must have? They must have radio transmitters. They must be listening to us, Lou.
This game, I don't think that's possible. I don't think this game is going to be shown for any recruiting situations or any highlights at the end of the year. Here is a pass, incomplete. Philip Wendler, the intended receiver.
For Coach Tosh, there are not many positives that you can take away from this game. Up until now, both the offensive and the defensive coaches have said that even in their loss to Harvard last week, that they have gotten better in different aspects of the game every single week. I have to believe they've taken a pretty significant step back this week, Lou.
Burnham, play action, runs out of there, puts the ball down. No, he throws a run. Receiver open, incomplete, inside the 5-yard line, intended for Drew Faulkner. But sure looked like Burnham was over the line of scrimmage when he let that ball go.
It looked like he could have been anywhere from 2 to 5 yards beyond the line of scrimmage. See a shuttlecock down there on the ground. If we saw it up here, I'm sure that the ref saw it down there.
Yeah, that's a penalty against Princeton. That's an illegal forward pass, obviously. Loss of down. And it brings up a fourth down. Watch it again. Now watch Burnham. The line of scrimmage at about the 45-yard line.
Well, he's trying to make something happen. I give him credit for that. He had some room to run, but again, his eyes lit up when he saw a wide-open receiver down there. Unfortunately, in his enthusiasm, he ran past the line of scrimmage.
Fourth and 10 for the Tigers at the 45. Officials call timeout momentarily. Let's see what this might be. So the Tigers with a 4th and 10, trailing 17-0. 3 minutes and 45 seconds left. And Fisher went over and talked to both head coaches. I'm not exactly sure what's going on down there, but now play is back in. Burnham goes into the shotgun. Snap to Burnham. He looks. Has protection. Now he steps up. Fires. It is incomplete. Threw into coverage. Nearly picked at about the 22. Hanks had an opportunity. And Columbia will take over on downs. The Lions leading 17-0.
Good protection by Princeton's offensive line. Burnham steps up. He's got a lively arm. He wings the ball downfield. There was an open receiver. It looked to be number 34, Kyle Brandt, a running back. Was overthrown.
Thomason at quarterback, hands it off, big hole, and then diving ahead as Demler just throws him to the ground. Norman Hayes at about the 41.
Well, you know what it was? I think the refs were bringing life preservers actually over to the coaches. Field seems to be flooding.
If you take a look at the track, which goes around the field here at Wien Stadium, it just is. It's just raining extremely hard at this point. From about the middle of the second quarter on, the rain has been falling hard. Windswept rain.
Not a day for man or beast. But a good day to go to McCaffrey's.
Second down, and we'll talk about that in a moment as Zambia comes up to the line of scrimmage. I formation. Hand off up the middle. And across the 40. It'll be third down. This telecast of Princeton University football, sponsored in part by McCaffrey's Supermarkets. McCaffrey's does catering. for the best the season has to offer, whatever the occasion. McCaffrey's has the answer. Tailgate parties, casual events, or formal affairs, you can count on McCaffrey's to make it easier on you. McCaffrey's, a supermarket experience in Princeton, West Windsor, and Yardley, Pennsylvania. 3 minutes and 11 seconds remaining in the game. It'll be third down at about four for Columbia. Ball sits at the 39-yard line.
Well, we've had a coming of age here for number 34, Norman Hayes. Young in age and experience, but playing like a veteran. This is their third team running back, Lou. This is an unbelievable job. And again, a great effort, great individual effort. Great ball possession today. Don't believe he's fumbled the ball. And rushed for probably getting close to 150 yards now.
Hand off. Hayes. He's down near the 35-yard line. That's close to a Columbia first down. That might be enough. We'll see where they spot the football. It is just across the 35, and that would be enough for the first down, and it is. Columbia picks up a first down. They'll retain possession with 3:05 left in the game. The Lions looking to just run out the clock here.
Well, the only thing left is the crying and the screaming, so to speak. Columbia with just a great individual effort. Great team effort. Following up a big win last week at Yale with their second win in a row and their second win in the Ivy League.
And running ahead of the field at the 20 to the 10. Fumble! Ball is loose at the 10-yard line. And it looks like Princeton has recovered, and they have. Norman Hayes had a huge hole and then was hit. Ball came loose. And Princeton recovers at the 10.
Well, it's too bad that he actually couldn't held on to that, Lou. He's had a great game, and the Columbia offensive line has done a phenomenal job. We need to give them credit. He's run right off tackle, big number 60, Matt Radley, and number 74, Ray Jarena, springing that hole for number 34, Norman Hayes. When he got down to the 10-yard line, Princeton defender, number 9, Damani Leach, jarred the ball loose.
Burnham running the football, and he is nailed at the 15. Norman Hayes today ties the record for the most carries in a game by a Columbia back. Really a big part of the Columbia offense. In fact, he was the Columbia offense today. Little procedure looks like the call against Princeton.
You know, anytime we talk about the performance of a running back, we can't neglect, and I have neglected, talking about the outstanding job that Columbia's offensive line has done. We got Brian Gordon, a center starting, a freshman starting at center, and then Arena, the right guard, Matt Radley, the right tackle, Marcellus Deans, the left guard, Jay DePertius, the captain, all deserve an enormous amount of credit against what was one of the best defenses, and is one of the best defenses in the Ivy League.
Minute 55 remaining. Burnham looks to throw. Steps up now at the 10, lets it fly, nearly intercepted. Almost picked by Hasheem Dalton, the strong safety.
And Dalton's had a spectacular game in the first half. His interceptions, well, his second interception set up Columbia's first touchdown. So we've had some great individual efforts in addition to great individual efforts by all the part of the Columbia offensive linemen. Moving the ball consistently on the Princeton defense.
Princeton third down and 10 at the 10-yard line with a minute 47 left. Burnham rolls out left side, looks, throws, and it is incomplete. Intended for Crowley at the 27-yard line. It'll bring up a fourth down. So Princeton will look to kick the football out of there.
Burnham getting some valuable experience He's number two on the depth chart. He's a junior. He'll be asked to carry the load next year, in all likelihood, for Princeton.
Columbia shutting out Princeton, of course, 17-0. The last time the Lions shut out the Tigers, 1972, it was a nothing-nothing tie.
That just figures, doesn't it?
So Matt Evans will stand in the end zone. Good snap. Wind at his back and lets a booming kick go. Hanks tries to field it at the 35 off of his shoulder pads. Picks it up at the 40. Cuts across the 43-yard line. And Columbia will put it in play there with a minute 27 seconds
remaining in the game.
Well, Hanks, Lou, he's a very capable punt returner. Actually, in his sophomore season, he was second in the nation in punt returns, averaging 16.5 yards per return.
There's a penalty flag down at the 40, and this looks like it'll go against the Lions, so this will push Columbia back to about the 30-yard line or so. Holding is the call.
Columbia looking to just run the clock out here.
First time that Princeton has been shut out by Columbia in 25 years. Wow, what a span.
They tell you're deserving a lot of credit.
Out of the eye, the give is to Norman Hayes, who's had a huge game. He rolls across the 35, up near the 36-yard line, a pickup of 5 on the play. A minute 15 left. It'll be 2nd and 5 for Columbia.
It's a phenomenal effort. I can't overemphasize the effort that, you know, the Columbia offense has done. Princeton has held in check some of the most powerful and potent Division I AA offenses in the country. You know, Columbia coming into this game, you know, ranked number 6 in the Ivy League in total offense. And they've played like one of the better teams, offensive teams in the league.
Hayes still running hard. And he's up near the 40-yard line, gets to about the 38 or so. With 30 seconds left, Columbia is ready to put this one in the books. The Lions will improve to 3-4 on the year and 2-2 in the Ivy. Clock winding down with 15 seconds left. Columbia begins its celebration. Big win for Columbia. That'll be 2 Ivy League wins in a row against Yale now and Princeton. As the clock ticks down, that's the final score. Columbia 17 and Princeton nothing. Nice victory for the Columbia Lions, who now improved to 3-4. And as we said, 2 Ivy League victories in a row over Yale and Princeton for the Tigers. This is a very tough loss. They just never got it going today offensively. And Princeton, quite frankly, they just didn't rise to the occasion today.
They didn't. And what exacerbated that, obviously, was the weather. They probably got a few bad breaks that were a little disheartening initially, which resulted in fumbles. But they did a poor job of handling the ball all day. And it was clear that at least one team out on the field was able to execute. They were able to hold on to the ball, with the exception of that last fumble by Norman Hayes. Columbia was able to keep the ball off the turf. In addition, they had great individual efforts by 2 players. One that was really important in the first half, Lou. He had 2 interceptions for the Columbia defense, and that was the defensive back Hashim Dalton, number 12, the strong safety, and then Norman Hayes. You know, what can we say about Norman Hayes? He's a sophomore playing in only his second game as a running back, second back-to-back 100-yard game.
Well, quite obviously, the Tigers are not really in the Ivy League race at this point as they lose this one. There's 3 games left, Penn, Yale, and Dartmouth. If you're Steve Toshis, how do you approach these next 3 games for the Tigers?
Well, you know, Toshis has established a tradition of winning at Princeton. He's the winningest coach in the Ivy League, and I believe he's in the top 3 of Princeton's all-time winningest coaches. These players have played with a lot of emotion all year long, and the seniors, they have very strong senior leadership. I think that these guys are going to want to go out on a winning note. And now at this point, they have three games remaining, and they can really act as spoiler. They can play Dartmouth, and they can go out with three consecutive wins, and that'd be a heck of a season after a 3-7 season last year.
All right, that'll do it from Baker Field in New York City at Columbia University. Columbia with a big win, 17-0 over Princeton. For Pete Milano and everyone here at RCN Sports, I'm Lou Brogno. Thanks for joining us. Again, the final, Columbia 17 and Princeton nothing.
Lagasse here, kicking off the Food Network's Bam Bam San Diego Jam Sweepstakes. You can win up for two to the Super Bowl, tickets to the Taste of the NFL, and a pregame brunch with me. Just watch the Food Network and find my Bam logo on the screen. Mail a postcard with the date, time, program, your name, address, and phone number by November 9th to this address.